Welcome to Libertarian Counterpoint. On today's panel, we have Gale Morgan, Secretary of the Libertarian Party of California, David Peters, a long-term Libertarian, founding member perhaps.
Close.
My name is Lee Welter. I have been a member of the Libertarian Party for a number of years now, and I keep trying to learn and thankful, very, very thankful to people such as my two panelists here who helped educate me. We have a few topics to talk about tonight, but the first one revolves around a recent movie titled Waiting for Superman. It's something I encourage everybody to watch because it has a lot to say about a very powerful government monopoly that has had a very profound effect on our nation and especially our children. Have you seen the movie yet, Gale?
I have not.
I recommend that you do it.
I probably will.
I hope so.
With all this prodding, I probably will.
Good. And David, I think you saw Waiting for Superman already. Do you want to tell us a little bit about it?
I was very impressed with it. The gentleman who produced it, Davis Guggenheim, was the guy who also did Al Gore's Flack.
Oh, yes. An Inconvenience, something or other.
Inconvenient, yes.
So he's really good at emotional
and
hooks.
No, he wasn't. He tried to beat...
Well, in a way, yes.
True, but in this, he wanted to find out what the problem was with public schools. Because his kids were in a private school. He could afford it. And they'd asked him several times to do this, and he didn't want to get involved in it. And finally, one day, decided he would and started looking into it. And he ended up talking with Mr. Kanata, who's the director of a public school charter program in New York City, who tells the story that when he was young and growing up in Harlem, he was waiting for Superman. Because Superman would come and save the day and get them out of the hellhole of the public schools that they were suffering through. And he said, the greatest disappointment in my life was not finding out there was no Santa Claus, but that there was no Superman, and we couldn't escape. And the guy actually sounds a lot like Denzel Washington, which is really quite interesting.
I saw the movie. He's very effective.
Yeah, but the point was the school choice, because it brings parents back into it. Under the current system, parents have no say in what happens with their children. And they drop them off at 8 o'clock in the morning, pick them up at 3 o'clock, and pray they have not become brain damaged in the interim. But obviously all of us came out of a time when parents were involved, and the note, take this home to your mother, brought terror to your eyes because the world could come to an end. Nowadays, the kids look at it and say, you got to be kidding.
I have a tangent I can go on very briefly because I want to continue this, David.
Comes back to the idea of getting the parents involved. And that's why everything that has been done, all the way from charter schools to the old-fashioned PTA, where it actually took an interest and an active voice, to private schools, to anything, got the parents involved. Once the parents were involved, they paid attention to what their kids were doing. You had other movies, documentaries. One was Race to the Bottom, about the test-happy culture in public schools and pushing kids to take advanced classes that actually were at the level that the public schools used to teach 100 years ago, but with the dumbing down of standards, now everything's AP, advanced placement. And then there was, of course, Pacific Research Foundation did the myth of the middle-class school, which means your public school is not as good as you think it is. Just because it's in a nice suburb doesn't mean it's delivering.
So you think the schools have deteriorated over the past several decades.
And
the point I was trying to make very briefly, because I don't want to get off this topic, is that I can remember a time when any family where somebody in the house, typically the man of the house, had a full-time job, could afford to have mom stay at home, look after the household, and look after the children. Now, with taxes consuming close to 50% of all of our income, two parents have to work to support a family, which doesn't leave somebody right there to go to the PTA meetings. And
World War II.
World War II was part of it, but something else has happened.
That's when mom went back to work.
Yes, but there was a reason for that, supporting the war effort, but does that mean we have to increase taxes to such an extent that they can't afford to do otherwise?
No, but that's when it started.
It sure did.
And there was a tremendous tax increase to support the war.
Yes.
And usually after war, you saw some reduction in taxes after the war was over. However, after the Civil War, that reduction never took place. And for those of you of that ilk,
World War II.
The war between the states.
What, the Southern Rebellion? Please. I'm extremely partisan.
I'm a Southerner, so the war between the states, it was nothing civil about it. Thank you. But at that point, there was a certain amount of aggressive tax increase that was never relinquished. And World War II just advanced that even further. And although there was some drawdown after that, we've never gone back to the minimal taxation that we had prior to the war between the states.
Okay, so the education system is part of the price we're paying for that. And
well,
I think it deserves focus because without an educated populace, we are doomed.
But
we really are.
As much as I would disagree with everything you said about the end of the Civil War, it must be Southern propaganda.
Taxes didn't go back down?
Huh? Taxes did go back down. And the income tax was abolished, and habeas corpus was reestablished, and everything.
Didn't go back as low as it had
been. But the Southerners didn't have free labor anymore.
We use the Chinese to do that now.
No, they want to get paid, okay?
Not much.
The thing was that women working in the workforce here didn't really start until the 60s, even into the 70s. Men could still make enough money in the 50s to support a family, and the mother stayed home.
I remember that.
Very rarely would a mother go to work, and that was if, you know, she had a good education, and after the kids started school.
Typically.
So the fact that you didn't have many latchkey kids, because both parents had to work, but the big thing with the difference was the transfer of responsibility for the education of the child from the parents to the schools.
That was in the 70s.
Yes, and the schools said, we can do it. And we, in fact, we want to control what they're going to learn because we know best. And that might be good for the teacher in the classroom because there are a lot of good teachers out there. But most of the administration should be taken out and put up against the wall and et cetera. But it pays better to be an administrator.
So they all want
to
do that.
Those who can't teach become principals and go work in the downtown offices.
But there are some good schools.
Oh, yes, there are.
And they're good principals,
But this is
too.
What's funny, is that you myth of the middle-class school talked about the fact that you had these small-town school districts that had one or two schools, so there was really no competition. Yet, every major urban school district in the country that has used the weighted student average funding scheme, also called the Manitoba Plan.
Does that give families some choice?
Yes, because you can... Each student can enroll where they're accepted. And the schools compete for the students because all the funding comes with the student. They don't have to get a budget from downtown. The kid shows up with a check.
So it's almost a free market. Not totally free, but much more free than usual.
But it competition. San Francisco, where you had the school board that absolutely hated Arlene Ackerman, who was superintendent, because when they hired her, she said, I want this program, and they said yes. And then found out that it meant they had no power anymore. And the unions hated her because the principals hired the teachers, and if the school closed down, the teachers were out of work. And on all of this, in a school district that's screaming they had no money for anything, when she said, buy out my contract, they found $400,000 overnight. And her assistant would not take the job because I'm not working for those fools. That's like, you know, how masochistic do you think I am? But Ackerman had the weighted student average. It went from school to school. Schools closed because they couldn't get enough because the staff there wasn't doing the job. And there was a certain cutoff just from the point of view of overhead, but it was very small. You could have a school with 100 kids and it would work. But every year that this program was in place, and in L.A. and in New York and everywhere else it's been tried, test scores have gone up, maybe not dramatically, but consistently in all ethnic groups.
And if a school was failing, They could close it, is that right?
No, the parents would pull the kids out and put them someplace else.
Oh, but the school would fold then, I presume.
Well, it would fold because it had no customers.
Yes, sort of like what Michelle Reed did in Washington, D.C.
Yes, she was trying to do wage and student averaging, although she did it top down, but she got rid of a lot of the bureaucracy.
And they hated her for it.
Of course, because they had no power. All the power resided in being the one who said yes or no to any spending decision. And it all devolved down to the principals. So the thing was that you can have competition even in government schools, public schools, if there is true competition. In most public school systems, where everything is decreed from by the school district at headquarters, that's not competition. That's cookie cutter.
And many times that's from Washington, not the local school district.
No, actually, Arne Duncan is pushing for this kind of stuff. That's one of the few things that he at least wants, even if Obama can't do it, because he's bound, tied and gagged by the teachers' union, but Duncan can get away with it.
Oh, that's good.
United States Department of Education has educated how many children?
It was a way to send
funding. You think they're expendable?
Mm-hmm. He pushes for this kind of reform that breaks the power of the union.
Yeah. And I'm in favor of that, yeah. but I would challenge with the concept of state department and federal departments of education.
But see, again, they become useless in the final analysis if everything is determined at the school level by the principal. The only, you know, the idea of, for example, teachers scream, oh, you can't have those standardized tests because we have to teach the test. And you get the young teachers said, what, there's nothing there to teach? Of course there is. You've got teachers who don't want to be held accountable because basically the way they were held accountable was they got screwed. Mm. Okay? Because now they can test every child and measure each child year to year because they all have Social Security numbers, so they can track them. So they can now tell, all they're looking for is to see the teachers that can make an improvement year to year.
And there was one very
good. And it works.
David, there was one very dramatic episode. Popped to mind in the movie Waiting for Superman, mm-hmm. where Michelle Rhee reportedly proposed to the teachers' union a contract that would permit, on the basis of meritorious performance, some teachers, the best teachers, to double their pay.
More than
double their pay, but the other teachers would be cut if they didn't meet the criteria. Is that right?
No. Not exactly.
Okay, let's hear the real truth.
What they offered was a program whereby the teachers could earn on base pay and merit pay and bonuses a 120% increase in salary on one condition. They gave up tenure.
Oh, so they had to perform.
Yes, or get fired. And the union was so afraid of it that the union, and this is where Davis Guggenheim, you could hear almost hear him crying.
Because he was a true believer.
No, he thought, unions are a good thing. He realized the unions were the problem because the union would not even permit that contract to come to a vote. Yeah. And it did actually 2 years later, but the teachers' union still fought back because you had a lot of teachers who got there because they weren't particularly good at what they were doing, and they weren't going to take the chance of having somebody find out. But he offered a normal, they would get up to $82,000 after 3 years with tenure, or $128,000 without tenure. And teachers' union would not even allow it to come to a vote.
One of the problems with the school districts is they operate under the Peter principle.
No, actually, they operate under total cognitive dissonance. Because they say, we're a professional organization, and these teachers all have college degrees, and they have training, but we're going to treat them like assembly line workers, and assembly line workers get bounced if they have low-quality work. Teachers can't be fired.
But a teacher will get promoted to be a principal or a vice principal or a counselor until they're non-functional, and then they get left there.
The problem is that all the non-teaching jobs in a school district tend to pay more.
Yes.
With a lot less grief. You're not facing 30 little brats every hour, 5 hours a day. So you get paid a lot more money to be an administrator. So the really good teachers who just finally give up take an administrative position. Or the really bad ones because they would be found out.
That explains something I read once. And a researcher investigating some of the public school systems learned that the New York city public schools had a headquarters administration building with well over 2,000 employees.
Mm-hmm. Doing nothing.
He learned that the Catholic Archdiocese of New York City had approximately one-fifth, about 20% of the total number of students. He called their headquarters building and asked, how many administrative employees do you have in your organization or in your building? The woman who answered the phone said, I don't know. Nobody's asked that question before, but hold on just a moment and I'll find out. And he waited, and she came back on the phone. She said, 27 of us. Mm. Tells you something, doesn't it?
Hmm. Well, part of it is you have so many, even before you had the Department of Education, you had so many mandated federal programs, and you had to have somebody dedicated to monitoring them. So that meant more administrative staff. But this was all part of the budget for the school. So if you had an EEOC program, or you had any kind of Head Start or anything, it all had to have administrative staff to compile statistics and forward them on to whoever was paying for the extra money. Well, this counted as part of the administration, even though they weren't really administering as much as they were just keeping tabs.
I used to work for the North Sacramento Public School District. Mm-hmm. North Sacramento School District. Anyway.
Is that the one that's called Twin Rivers now? Grant High School?
It is part of it. And I also worked for Grant High School District. Mm-hmm. This was back in the 80s in both cases. Mm-hmm. And while I was at North Sacramento, they had to hire on a person who specialized in hazardous waste. Some of the buildings had asbestos in them. And so they had to hire a specialist to oversee any construction that dealt with the asbestos. And this had to be an administrator. And that's pretty close to all the person handled was how much lead did we have in the school? How much asbestos did we have in the school? What were we doing to abate those chemicals?
Neither one of which was a threat. Because of the junk science. There are three kinds of asbestos, and the ones used in schools is not the cause of asbestosis. You have rock asbestos, you have wool asbestos, and there's a third one, I can't remember the name of it now, but the only one that could grind down to a particle fine enough to get past the cilia in your lung was rock asbestos that was used for two purposes. Brake shoes.
Yes.
And battleship insulation around the guns. So the only two groups of people that were getting asbestosis were battleship mechanics in the shipyards.
Yes.
And auto mechanics.
Yes.
And all they had to do was put on a painter's mask.
Or race car drivers. Didn't we have?
No, only if they were in an enclosed area.
Oh, okay.
If you're out in the wind, it would disperse it so quickly.
Okay. Yeah, you're in the wind, it disperses.
Yeah.
But a paper mask will not filter out the fine fiber of the asbestos.
Well,
it will go through them.
Well, it depends on how fast you're sucking.
All right.
But there was, you could still, a mask would work.
All right.
To stop it.
Well, I used a respirator when I worked.
But I grew up in San Francisco, where we had asbestos wool was used to insulate all your furnace ducts.
Mm-hmm.
And that became, oh my God, a hazardous waste. So there was a case where they were cleaning up a school in San Francisco, dumped it onto a truck, took it onto the bridge to dispose of it in East Bay somewhere, and the back of the truck fell open and they dumped the asbestos onto the Bay Bridge, lower deck. Oh my God, 13 hours they closed that bridge. So they called some expert at Berkeley. What do we do with all this asbestos? Where'd it come from? Get a broom. What do you mean get a broom? Sweep it in the bay. This is not the stuff that gives you asbestos. Oh,
so
we can't do
true
that.
True expertise then.
No. They didn't want to listen because they had to go out and get people with tweezers to pick up every single grain of the stuff that would never cause asbestosis in the first place. But they had a bunch of smart lawyers around who were going to sue the pants off them. Okay, and juries that were, junk science is junk science, that's another show.
Totally. Oh, that's a different, yeah, we can't get off on
but
that tangent.
Back to the problem with monopoly, is that most people, it's like when UPS had a strike, who did you side with, the drivers or UPS? Who did you know?
I didn't.
All right, be that way, all right?
Well, I talked to somebody about unions who said would have child labor if we didn't have unions.
Wouldn't hurt. Somebody would probably get something productive out of it. That's the point. You knew the drivers. So you you instinctively took the driver's side. Comes in a case of in the schools, who do you know? You know your kid's teacher. Your kid's teacher is a nice person. So you know, when the union says they're speaking for the teacher, unless you go check and realize that the union is probably gagging the teacher, you will take the union side because the union purports to speak for the teacher.
Well, having worked in school districts, I know better.
But,
true,
and I've spoken to several
exception.
I've spoken to several teachers who say the unions don't really represent me.
I know, but they
I'm
can't. But
it.
They can't
That's
say
correct.
Anything.
They can't. Not
they,
publicly.
They, yeah, I know. So the problem is that we see a public face, which is not necessarily the reality. But because we know the teacher, we don't want to think the teacher is bad. And face it, even if you even if you oppose a union, you don't think a union is bad per se. They might be wrong. Quiet. Let me, you know. Unions serve a purpose. If it's a voluntary association, it's a voluntary association. It becomes a representative of a group of people.
That's great. But if it's coercive,
well, it's coercive because the government has given it powers that it would never give to any other association in our society.
Mm-hmm.
So that's a whole other story. But the thing is, with the unions, teachers' union, they come in and they present themselves as a professional association. And Randy Weingarten, or whatever her name is.
Oh, she was in the
in the Superman
movie.
Is a classic case.
She was
case.
Not flattering,
now,
or flattered.
Well, I know, but there's a classic case of Peter Principle.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, that woman was, she had no answer except, we want more for the teachers. That's her only answer. The woman was a broken record.
There was another president a few years back who was quoted as saying, we will look out for the students' best interests once they start paying union dues. Until then,
of course,
we will look out for our members. And that's the way it is.
Well, at least he's being honest.
He was, absolutely.
Which is more than she was.
Yes.
Okay.
You find that in many public information officers, that they have a canned report
of
what they're going to let out. And being a commissioner on one agency in town, I understand the job of the public information officer. It's not to disseminate information as much as it is to control the information that is disseminated.
Yeah.
And so this case you're describing here, and I haven't seen the movie, so I can't.
You will see the movie.
Please.
It's dramatic.
It's really
Please,
good.
Look at the movie, folks. Yeah.
But I understand perfectly what you're saying, that canned response.
Mm-hmm.
To me, it's a canned response. You saying she just was giving out just this is all she knew. No, this is a very planned output. This
of
is
course.
The way they do it. And this is how they control what your image of them is.
But he let her open her mouth and stuff both feet down it.
Yes.
With the final comment that the union would not allow that proposal to come to a vote.
But
and Michelle Rhee, who's now married to Kevin Johnson, mayor of Sacramento, will never get a chance to do it here. Because, number one, the mayor doesn't have the authority to take over the school department, even though he should, probably. And the school board here would never hire her in the same way they would never hire Arlene Ackerman, because the unions would oppose it in a heartbeat.
But I have something to say about that.
And union employees know how to vote the way they're told.
Michelle Rhee will be very influential, no matter. And
well,
I have great respect
so do I.
For Kevin Johnson because of his establishment of St. Hope Academy in St. Hope Schools. It's done wonders to several of the schools in Sacramento. Public School 7 for one, and Sacramento High School for another. And
that's great.
I have great admiration for him for instigating and overseeing it.
The Met down at 8th and V has a unique program. They actually have teachers there are with the class all day long. They teach all the subjects. And the kids all have to agree. They cannot graduate till they're admitted to college. And they have close to 100% graduation rate because the kids want to learn.
That's wonderful.
And they make it possible because it's a team effort. I mean, the teacher also follows them all the way through. They don't get a new teacher every year. They have the same teacher. So it's like having an uncle or an aunt who pays attention to you and knows all your little tricks and so on, and there's no mercy. There's also incredible, constant encouragement, and the kids learn, and they're all almost like 99.9, he said, are accepted to college. And this is a public school.
And we respect that. Mm-hmm.
It can work.
Yes, and okay. I should emphasize that, though, as libertarians, we have a certain mistrust of government, And we prefer to have more competition than our government school monopoly offers. We don't want to destroy the existing school system. We want to make it better.
And you call it a government school. It started off as a public school because it was for all the public.
Personal belief on the public school system is, and I'm not willing to say to go dismantle it like one of the candidates this past session did, but if we could put the private schools on an even par with the public schools.
Well, it was vouchers.
The voucher system has been very effective, especially in Washington, D.C., but guess what happened to it?
Any way you make them equal, vouchers or otherwise, any way you make them equal is, I think, a positive thing.
Yes.
And you get the competition in there. I think that in the long run, the government schools cannot compete unless they go greatly out of their way to change what they're doing now.
This is why the weighted student averaging was the best venue to get the idea out there, that the idea is to educate the child.
Right.
And the child can then take that check and go to Lowell High School, or can take that check and go to Boys High or Lick Wilmerding in San Francisco and find a way to pay the difference. Because if the goal is to educate the child, but the goal is not, the goal is to hire teachers.
Right.
And keep them employed long beyond any useful shelf life.
I found something fascinating to me in our local prominent newspaper early last year, where a particular family was moving from Chicago to Washington, D.C. The question raised in the popular press was, where should those children go to school? Should they go to a public school? Should they go to a private school? Should they find a charter school? And to my delight, the superintendent of our county schools was quoted as saying, the family is the correct entity to make that choice and to make that decision.
Absolutely.
Unfortunately, most people can't afford to pay twice for schools. The government public schools with their taxes and the tuition for a public school such as Sidwell Friends School, private school, such as Sidwell Friends Academy in Washington, D.C., if you could come out.
Yeah,
so we're depriving people of the funding, and if everybody had the money following the students, things would be much better. We look forward to that.
If the goal is to educate the kids.
Yes.
And it makes you wonder.
And it should be.
Yes.
And I'm delighted that we went into depth on this particular topic. Educating our children and our populace is of vital importance. We will have similar topics in future episodes of Libertarian Counterpoint. Thank you, Gail Morgan. Thank you, David Peters. Thank you, Lee Welter, for your contributions to this. Thanks for joining us, folks. Look forward to you in the near future.